Okay, so let's begin from where we left off the other day. We did the analysis of the VM, the midpoint voltage for the inverter characteristic, right? And we found that essentially it comes out to be, it can be sort of expressed as one function, R by 1 plus R. Times the supply voltage, right? Where R is equal to this expression, right? So with this expression, what we found is, if we want to balance it and get R equal to 1, that is to say the VM equal to 1/2, the midpoint, actually at the midpoint of the supply voltage, we would want to make WP by WN in the ratio mu N by mu T, right? So because the mobility of the N-type MOSFET, the mobility of the electrons in the N-type MOSFET is higher, right? Therefore, we find that if we want to make the PMOS also symmetric and we want to make the voltage transfer characteristic symmetric, then we would like to make WP equal to twice of WN. Okay? Now, it turns out this is also a good thing from the point of view of the current delivery characteristic. It makes the current being delivered by it more or less equal. Okay. Alright, so the next thing that we are interested in, and we are going to try and estimate once again, is the noise margin. Okay. So how did we define the noise margin from the voltage transfer characteristic? What we said was, the VTK looks something like this. So, we want to look for this point and this point. Right? And both of these essentially correspond to the areas where any increase in the input voltage beyond this is going to actually get amplified at the output. Okay, so any noise that comes when you increase the voltage beyond this is going to get amplified at the output and taking further and further away from the logic input level. Okay, so this is sort of the limit of what I can consider as a voltage input low or input high. Okay, and we would like to estimate these values. Now the problem is, even though we found some expression for VN, that is the midpoint voltage, it's very difficult to find one closed form expression for the entire voltage transfer characteristic, that is VO versus VI. Okay? It's not very clear how you would go about doing that. The simplest way is pretty much by just plot the curve. Right? Evaluate the currents at different values of the input. Equate the currents in the PMOS and NMOS. Find out what the output voltage should be. And from there get output characteristics. Alternatively, the other method is use the load curve. Right? You have the NMOS ID versus VDS characteristic, you have the PMOS ID versus VDS characteristic, superimpose them on top of each other. For every value of VDS, or rather VGS, which is the input voltage, you can find out what is the corresponding VDS, which is the output voltage. Okay? As the intersection of the two sides. So, those are typically the ways by which the input versus output characteristics are derived, but that doesn't help us in terms of finding out at which point the slope becomes equal to minus 1. Okay? You can of course do it graphically. What we would like to do over here is get an estimate of the same thing just from the equation. Okay? And this estimate is going to be like our R by 1 plus R. It's not accurate, but it helps to tell us what we should change. Should I make WT bigger or smaller, WN bigger or smaller? Are there any other parameters that affect the noise margin and so on? Okay? Alright, so for doing that, we are going to make an approximation. Okay? There. As you would have noticed, quite a lot of what we are doing, the computations over here are approximations. Like I said, you can't do the things accurately. The best method to get correct or close to accurate values is PI simulation, because that has a very detailed transistor model. If you don't want to do that, you make approximations and do the calculations by hand. So, in the present instance, what's the approximation that we are going to make? This is the actual voltage transfer characteristic. I'm going to make another approximation which says that this red dash curve is the actual voltage transfer characteristic. Right? So in other words, piecewise linear. I approximate the entire voltage transfer characteristic as three lines. Okay? Now this actually seems to complicate things further, because now I don't have any, and this is not differentiable anymore. It's not, right? There are 2 points over there where there is an abrupt change of direction. Okay? So I can't really get a slope of -1. But what I'm going to say is this point and this point. This is the VIS, or rather VIL, and this is VIL. I'm just going to define those 2 points. Okay? Now how is this helping me? How this helps me is, I can now just compute the slope over here. And based on this slope and the midpoint voltage, I can straight away find out what are the values of the noise margin. How is that? Once I am given this midpoint voltage over here, I know that that's going to lie on this sloping region. Okay. What is the VIX going to be compared to VM? What is this entire distance from here to here? How much is it? This is VDD. Right? So now how much is this? It is VIS minus VIL, yes. But in terms of VDD and that slope, what's the equation for a line? Right? What is the delta y? It's equal to slope times delta x. Right? Delta y by delta x is equal to the slope. I have the delta y. I want to find delta x. So VDD divided by slope. Okay? I'll call this slope g. Okay? So VDD by G is the VIX minus VIL. Okay? And assuming a symmetric characteristic, we can sort of say that VIX is approximately VM plus VDD by 2G, because half of that. Okay? VM minus VDD by 2G. So in other words, VN we already know how to calculate, and we know how to make it symmetric. In this case, I am also assuming that it's symmetric. That's not really necessary, right? The rest of the equations will hold, so we don't really need it to be completely symmetric also, right? But assuming that this is the case, what we have is VIH is higher than VN, okay? The total distance between VIH minus VIL I can calculate. It's VDV divided by V. And assume that that is symmetrically located on both sides of the character. Okay? This is an approximation, so it doesn't really matter that it's not accurate. What is important is, what is it telling us? It's telling us that this noise margin, what are some of the characteristics already we know that are going to affect this? One is the spacing between 0 to VDD. Right? The higher the supply voltage, the higher the noise margin. Okay? That comes out straight away from this. And that's actually an interesting, and it's an obvious, but an important realization. Right? You operate at higher supply voltages because you want better noise margin. Otherwise, instead of 1.8 volts, I could have operated at 1.5 or 1.2 or even maybe 0.9 or even lower than that. What happens as a result? The result is that the noise margin shrinks. Okay? We already know that sort of from a graphical point of view. This is also converting it into an equation and telling you how it's related. The other important thing that comes out of this equation is that slope. Okay? DVO by DVI in the region of VN. Okay? That is a crucial parameter that we are interested in. Okay? We want that slope to be high or low? As high as possible. Right? Ideally, you want it to be a vertical line. Right? Infinite slope. If you can't get infinite slope, you at least make it as high as possible so that the dV divided by G becomes as small as possible so that the VIL becomes the highest possible, VIH becomes the lowest possible. The bands that are considered input low and input high are made as wide as possible. Okay? Alright, so now let's proceed further and see how we can estimate that G. Okay? Now, for this, once again we write the current balance, okay? And the equations here are quite messy. Okay? So what I am going to do in this case is I have already got them written out, so I am pretty much just going to copy them in place. Hopefully I don't make a mistake. But I would encourage you to sort of go through it and do the calculations once more on your own. Clear? Audible in the back now? Okay. Right. So like I said, I'm going to write out the equation. They are a bit messy. Please go through the computations once again on your own. Right? They're not very hard. It's just that you need to keep track of a number of different parameters out here. Okay? So first thing of course is the simple part. IN, the current through the NMOS, must be equal to the current through the PMOS. Okay. Now, these are in the, we are once again going to assume that they are in the velocity saturation region. Okay. So the current is going to be given by Kn right, where Kn essentially captures all of those, mu and T of W n by L n. Okay. am writing DGTN to represent DGS minus DT of N. Okay. I'm intentionally using a space over here. I'll get back to that. Sorry, actually it should not be VGT. We know what the value is. It's VGT or rather VI minus VTN. Okay. And on the other side we have VGT minus VI, which is the VGS of the CMOS. Now, what I'm going to say is, along with this, we also need to consider the channel length modulation. So why is that? Why is it that I did not consider channel length modulation in the previous case when I was calculating Gn? But now suddenly I am saying no, look, it can't be ignored. Huh? Exactly. There is no V out otherwise. Okay? Remember that in the saturation or velocity saturation regions, the current in the transistor is assumed to be independent of the output voltage, that is to say the VDS. Okay? But we know that that's an approximation. In reality, there is a channel length modulation which causes some slight upward trend. Okay? So if I ignore that upward trend, I'm essentially sort of saying this is an ideal transistor. Vout does not depend on Vin, which means what? The slope is infinity. Okay? In the previous case, when I was computing Vn, the contribution due to this 1 plus lambda Vout is very small. Okay? So whether or not I consider that 1 plus lambda Vout, I will get more or less the same answer. Right? At most, I might have to make an approximation, finally saying that 1 plus lambda Vout is approximately equal to 1 and move on, because otherwise I won't be able to simplify the equation. Okay? But over here, if I do that, then Vout just disappears from the entire current balance, which means that I am considering ideal transistor, slope of infinity. Okay? This is giving us one clue. It's telling us that, look, those lambda parameters have a strong influence on that slope. So the noise margin of the slope in the central region is strongly affected by your channel length modulation. Okay? How much is it? Let's simplify this equation and find out. Not quite simplify the equation. What we first need to do is, rather than just sort of, we are not solving for Vout versus Vi. What we want is to get dVout by dVi. Right? So what we can do is, take d by dVi and group terms together. Okay. Remember when you are applying d by dvi, dgi by dvi is 1, dv out by dvi is this g that we are trying to find. Okay. Everything else in these equations is a constant with respect to vi. Those are the only two things that depend on vi. Okay. Otherwise kn, vd sat, vt, all of those are constants. Okay. So do this in the computation and simplify. And finally it works out something like this. Thank you. equation looks messy, but has structure to it. What is the structure? This entire thing, this Kn, Vd, Fat, N, etc., all of this is essentially In. Right? This is It. And you know that In is equal to It. Okay? You take all of this out, group things together. I'm just going to write ID, which is the drain current of either NMOS or PMOS, they are both the same. How do I get this? I'm neglecting the 1 plus lambda into V out, etc. term. Okay? So, this is part of the trick that you need to do over here, right? Knowing what to neglect and when to neglect it. If I neglected the lambda terms right at the beginning, I would have got infinity as my result, which is wrong. But over here, if I neglect the lambda term, it doesn't make any real big difference to my final answer. So it's safe to neglect. Okay? So a couple of things at least that we can take away from this equation, right? One of them is the lambda. What do we want the slope to be? We want this slope V to be as high as possible, right? So the lambda parameters need to be as low as possible. Okay? So the lower the value of lambda, the higher the value of G or the midpoint slope. Similarly, Kn and Kt, right? Apart from the mobility, of course, Kn and Kt are slightly in our control, are in our control because they have the W and L parameters, right? The L is always kept at minimum. So the Wn and Wt values at least can be K. Okay? So once again, what is this telling us? Both Wn and Wt, the higher that they are, the better as far as the slope is concerned. Except that effect sort of cancels out because there is also an ID term. So if I make Wn or Wt larger, the ID also increases, this other term also increases. Okay? So in other words, this channel length modulation is probably the single most important factor that governs your final midpoint slope. Okay? Yeah. It holds whether it's velocity saturated or not. Because the channel length modulation is a different thing which is sort of affecting the depletion width over there. Okay? So it is actually changing the length of the channel. What we are saying is this is velocity saturated. But at the same time, there is also a channel length modulation effect. Sorry? No, it doesn't matter. Even when the depletion width, see, this, even in the linear region, actually channel length modulation has some part to play. Because all that is happening is the moment the Vd increases, right, there is a reverse bias diode over there, NP junction. The voltage across that, as it increases, that depletion width increases. That changes the amount of channel that needs to get inverted. That's sort of the intuitive understanding of channel length modulation, right? The length of channel that needs to get inverted is being decreased. So that holds whether or not you have velocity saturation, whether or not you have pinch off. Right? So, this is enough to sort of give us an estimate of the noise margin. Okay, and we can do the calculations from this. I'm not going to go ahead and do the computations itself. The purpose of this exercise was more to sort of go through and find out what are the things that affect your noise margin most strongly. Okay. So now we have looked at the ideal inverter, the ideal inverter characteristics, and practical inverters in the sense that what happens to the midpoint voltage, what happens to the noise margin in a practical inverter. Okay. Now it's time to move further. The next topic that we are going to take up is related to propagation delay, and this is a very important part of the overall analysis of digital circuits. Okay. So before we get into propagation delay as such and the definition of propagation delay and so on, first we want to get an understanding of why is there even such a concept? Why is there a propagation delay? How do we model the circuits in order to understand propagation delay in circuits? Okay. So now let's consider a simple inverter. Okay. Now this inverter in practice is going to be connected to the input terminal of some other gate, some other logic gate. That gate could be another inverter, or it could be a NAND gate, it could be a NOR gate, XOR gate, doesn't matter. Right? There are many different kinds of gates which we'll see later how to implement. But the point is, it's going to be some kind of a gate which is, once again, as we can expect from this course, some CMOS substrate. Okay? So in other words, it's going to be connected to some box, some black box, which is also a CMOS gate. Okay? What does that mean in terms of what it looks like to the inverter? What would it look like to the inverter? Would it look like a resistance? Would it look like a voltage source? Would it look like a current source? Would it look like a capacitance, inductance? What? So substantially what you are expecting is, let's assume that the other CMOS gate is also an inverter. Right? Simplest assumption possible. In other words, it looks like this. So this terminal is connected to these two terminals, right? This is an insulating gate of a PMOS. Insulating gate of a NMOS. Both of them are capacitance. Right? What do I mean by their capacitance? There is no continuous current that can flow through them because they are insulators. But we already saw how a MOS gate, MOS transistor, looks like a capacitor. Right? The CG. Okay? So in other words, one approximation that I can make is to say this looks like this. Okay? And from here there is another inverter which takes over and drives further down the line. As far as this particular unit is concerned, I need to be concerned only with its immediate surrounding. Okay? So there is some load capacitance CL that is connected to the output of the inverter. Okay? Now, what does the inverter itself look like? I know that this output now looks like a capacitance. Let's say that the input is going high to low. what will happen to the output? It will go. What happens to the output in this case? Low to high, what does that mean? How does the capacitor go from 0 volts to VDD? Some current has to be flowing into the capacitor, right? Depositing charge on the capacitor. In this case, what we know is, initially the input was high, which means that the NMOS was on, the PMOS was off. Finally, at this point, over here NMOS was on, PMOS was off. Over here NMOS is off, PMOS is on. Okay? So what has happened, in other words, is the PMOS has turned on. It now acts like it supplies current. Where does that current go? Not into the NMOS, because the NMOS is now off. Instead, that current goes into this capacitance, charging up the capacitance. Okay? And as a result of charging up the capacitance, the final voltage across that capacitance becomes eventually VDD. Okay? The question is, what does the PMOS look like during this process? Does it look like a current source? Does it look like a voltage with a resistance in series? Does it look like some other nonlinear function of all of the above? What is it? What is the PMOS going to behave like? What is it that finally governs the behavior of the PMOS? The voltage transfer characteristics. Okay? Well, not the voltage transfer characteristics, the current versus voltage characteristics. For a given voltage across the input and across the output, what is the current that is going to flow through it? That is determined by those static characteristics. Okay? So at the end of the day, we can be pretty sure that this is not going to act either like a pure current source or like a voltage source with a resistance in series. It's going to act like something complicated, which is a function of its ID versus VDS characteristics. Okay? Question is, what is the best approximation that we can make, which allows us once again to do a lot of hand calculations and understand how the circuit behaves? Okay? So what we do here is, we say that this is approximately like a voltage source, or let me draw that better. This is VDD, some resistance RT, why T? Because it's the resistance of the PMOS transistor. And this CL. I'm going to make this approximation. Okay? This is the so-called first order propagation delay approximation. Why first order? Because it first order essentially gives, you know, conveys the meaning that it is only a rough approximation. There are a number of details that have been omitted over here. Okay? It is also assuming that all the elements are completely linear. This is not the case in reality. Right? So the first order approximation is to say that this is a voltage source with a resistance in series driving the capacitor. Okay? Now, what happens in the other case? When we have the input going high, output going low, at that point, this is what the equivalent circuit looks like. Right? Because when the output is going low, how is it going low? Because the input has gone high, the NMOS is now on, the PMOS is off, so no current is coming from the voltage source. whatever charge was there on that output capacitance CL now has to go to ground. How can it go to ground? Through the transistor which is on, which is the NMOS transistor. Okay. So all of that charge gets dumped to ground through the NMOS, and that's the equivalent circuit that we can use for modeling. Okay. So now comes the question, how do I estimate this Rn and Rp? That is number one. And of course, once we have that, you know, what is the actual value of the propagation delay? Right? So as far as the value of the propagation delay is concerned, let's consider this simple circuit. Initially assume that the capacitor C is discharged. With this circuit, what will the voltage across the capacitance look like as a function of time? It's going to be exponentially increasing towards this supply voltage. What is the exact equation going to be? 1 minus e to the power of minus t divided by r t. Okay. So when t is equal to r t, V out is approximately equal to how much? One minus E inverse, right? So somewhere around 0.7 or thereabouts. Okay. Alternatively, at what point does V out become equal to VGD by 2 is also another question that we can ask. Okay. Now, all of those are okay. You can ask different questions and you will get different answers. Either I can ask, okay, what happens when t is equal to rk and find out how much is output voltage, or I can find out how much should be the time taken for v to reach vgd by 2, or I can ask how much is the time taken for v to go from 10% of vgd to 90% of vgd. Okay. All of those are valid questions. The important point is all of those times are going to be proportional to this value. Right? So as far as we are concerned, we are just going to take this number, RC, as an approximation of the propagation delay itself. Okay? In some books you will see the 0.7 term, 0.7 RC being taken into account, because that is a bit more accurate in the, if you define your propagation delay as going from 0 to 50%. Okay. Now how exactly is propagation delay defined and so on, we will get to the exact definitions later. But right now the most important thing is that this RC is the determining factor, is the term that we are actually interested in computing. Okay. As long as you know what RC is, it means that you have an estimate of how much is the delay through the circuit. Okay. Alright, so now if we go back to this, what it means is we want to be able to find out what is the RP, the equivalent resistance of the PMOS, and RN, the equivalent resistance of the NMOS. Okay. How do we find those values? What does it even mean? What is an equivalent resistance for a nonlinear device like a transistor? Okay. What does that actually mean? And how do we estimate it? So let's consider a NMOS. This is the current flowing through it, the voltage across it, plus minus VDA, and some value VGS, right? Gate to source voltage. Okay? Now what we are saying is, we are interested in the case where VGS is equal to VDD. Okay? So the transistor, in other words, is fully on. When this happens, our curve looks something like this, right? There is some tangent modulation and so on, various other effects. Finally, it's going to look something like this. This is VDS equal to VDD. And this is the ID. So, okay. What does the pure resistance look like on an I versus V characteristic? Linear, straight line. Right? So a pure resistance would have looked like a straight line. Right? It might have looked something like this. This corresponds to R equal to what? What is the value of this R? Given by V by I, right? Any V by any I, because that's called a straight line, it's proportional. VDD divided by ID max. Okay? Where this point over here is ID max. What does some other slope over here look like? This is some other R. Is this greater or lesser than ID max, than the other R, the VDD by ID max? For a given change in current, the change in voltage is smaller, so lesser value of R, right? Now what is the resistance of the NMOS transistor? What should we say is the resistance of the NMOS transistor? Is it any one of these values or something else? Because what is actually going to happen to the NMOS transistor? It's going to go along this curve, right? Because the input has been abruptly changed. Let's assume that the input has been abruptly changed from 0 to VDD. The moment the input is now at VDD, it means that the transistor now lies on this characteristic, on this part of the ID versus VDS characteristic, corresponding to VGS equal to 1.8. So any movement that is made, any change of current versus voltage, is going to be some movement along this line. At one end, the resistance is given by VDD divided by ID max. At another end is given by some other value, which is a bit less than VDD by ID max. You could probably take it as the slope of the curve in the linear region. Okay, that would be the actual R over there. In reality, this is going to be some kind of an approximation or an average of the across all of it. Okay? So what is usually done in practice is, of course, in the more accurate way is to use a simulation and to find out what is the equivalent resistance. If you want to estimate it, one thing you could do is say that I'll consider VDD by ID max and put some kind of a derating factor, an averaging factor. Okay? And an averaging factor, if you sort of go through the integral and so on, one possible averaging factor is 3 by 4. VDD by ID max. Okay? Alright, so we'll stop here for now. What we want to do next is to sort of get an estimate of what this value looks like for typical 180 nanometer process, and then continue with the first order propagation delay, saying okay, now we have the R, let's estimate the C, estimate the RC time constant, and based on that, how do we sort of build up on the overall model of delay of the inverter and similar gate. Okay.